Today on Real Life, the election caused division, but how should the church heal? The pastors are in the house tackling that very question. Plus, it's another miracle in American history, how a force of nature was part of God's divine intervention. And the rich tradition of Greek Orthodox Christmas hymns. Real Life starts right now.
This is Real Life. God loves you. Jesus died for you. The Holy Spirit, He empowers you. And the Bible is your and my guide to abundant life. I'm your host, Don Black. I'm here with my co-host for life, Terry.
Hello, everybody. Welcome. Guess what? Today is really 25 days till Christmas.
First day of December.
That's
We're
right.
already in December.
First day. And I am in honor of the first day of December. I am wearing a poinsettia. Brooch. So I am getting ready, and I hope that you are getting ready into celebrating Christmas.
Well, we're getting ready indeed. You ought to see our living room.
It's a mess.
Our living room. See, I'd take a picture and show you, but Terry would probably kick me in the,
I would kill
make me
you.
Sleep in the garage.
No, I really would not kill him, but I would be very upset.
Are you
with
threatening
him?
My life?
No, that's right. It's just I do things in phases, you know, when I have time, and so. But everything is gathered in the living room.
Well, the tree's up.
Yes.
And probably this evening we'll start putting things on the tree.
Oh, and you know what, though? It's sort of sad for us because when the kids were smaller, maybe some of you that have family, we would make a big deal of everybody would get together. Yeah. I'd make hot chocolate. We'd have Christmas music on. And we would put the Christmas ornaments on together. But now, as you know, our children are adults and young adults. They're all out and about. And so it's like I just sort of have to pull them and say, you need to put your Christmas ornaments on or, you know. So it's just a little bit different.
It's just Terry and me and the dog.
Well, Dylan.
Terry and me and
he's
the dog.
He's a busy senior.
He's
what
all
can we
over
say?
The place
he's
doing his own thing.
Right now, so.
But we'll get it done. It's going to be beautiful. It's going to be fantastic. We'll have to do it all in one time.
I know. That's why it's like we do it in phases, which makes it sort of messy in the house.
Last night, we got a text from our daughter in Tennessee.
I was in the middle of Bible study.
You tell the story.
Oh, I was in the middle of Bible study, and I get this text that says, this is not a drill. I might be going to jail. Call me as soon as possible.
Now, did you hear that? Make sure that you hear that. And she sent a text on her phone. This is not a drill. I might be going to jail. Call as soon as possible.
Yeah.
Explanation.
Right.
So I didn't get the text. I wasn't paying attention to phones, but yeah. Terry did.
I did. I of course, wouldn't you get up and you leave your Bible study and you go find out what's wrong? And lo and behold, she's not going to jail. She just got her email that her school loans are now due. That's what it's all about, and she's late.
It's kind of like going to jail.
So it was not a, it was just very difficult. It was a life awakening moment for her.
She's alive and well.
Yes, she's
and
fine.
Safe. And
yes.
And having to pay those student loans now.
Those come up.
Warning anybody who's watching, be careful with student loans. They'll give you a student loan for anything. Don't do it. Don't do it unless you have to. Mm-hmm. If you have to, do as little as you can because, you know, the Bible says that the debtor is in service to the lender. And you don't want to be like that. You know, I'm so glad that you tuned in today. What a special time. First of December, we're glad you're here. We have some wonderful guests. We're going to talk about history. We're going to see some stuff about history that I don't think you've ever seen, things I've learned. And, of course, the pastors are in the house.
That's right.
Facing a really tough question. We see God everywhere. Cindy goes out and looks for him in the headlines. Let's see what she's found.
I'm Sydney Grant for God in the Headlines. Here's your top story. A Christian teen is waging war on ISIS with his own unique arsenal. Nineveh's the Bit isn't turning to artillery, but art to take on the militants. The 17-year-old is rolling up his sleeves and recreating sculptures the group destroyed in Nimrud, Iraq. Thebit replicates the centuries-old artifacts as a sign of defiance. Up until last year, sculpting was just a hobby for Thebit. But once he saw ISIS destroy the ancient city sculptures, he knew he had to take a stand. Over the past year, Thebit has sculpted 18 statues and one mural. The teen was trained by his father, who's a sculptor himself. Thebit says his sculpture shows he will not be intimidated by ISIS.
All right, welcome to Hard Questions, where pastors come together and tackle the hard questions of the day. Dr. William Glaze on the far right from Bethany Baptist Church in Pittsburgh. Amen. Pastor Pete Giacalone from Rainbow Temple in McKeesport. Pastor Chris Gibbs from Crossway Church in Valencia. Good, there you got it. And Pastor J. Anthony Gilbert from Kingdom Restoration Christian Center in Pittsburgh. Well, brothers, let's jump right into this question. It's very pertinent. We're very sensitive in our culture. You know, the results of the election has caused a lot of division, a lot of strife, a lot of fear in people. How do we, or how do you guys, as pastors, start bringing that unity back together with your people? What's the way to that unity?
Yeah, you know, something that I was reading right after that, after the election, I was having some Bible time, and which I do more than just the election. But anyway, I was reading in 2 Chronicles, and in chapter 30, this is really great because, you know, King Hezekiah basically wants to reinstate the Passover, which hasn't been celebrated in a while. So he basically sends out communication to the northern kingdom, which is Israel, to invite them to come to the southern kingdom, which is Judah, in order to be a part of this. So it was the north and the south coming together. Political infraction had been there way before the United States ever came. Okay, and so he said, hey, we are still one people. We still have one God. Let's not let our political differences get in the way. And I think that we have to understand that we can't allow political differences to stand in the way of being one people who are serving one God.
Well, I believe with all of my heart, Don, and with the rest of the pastors, you know, Psalms 133 says, behold how good and how pleasant for brethren to dwell together in unity. And without unanimity, we'll never have the commanded blessings of God. So as pastors, we're going to have to work overtime on this. I remember right after the election, I told the congregation, I said, those of you who are Republican, don't gloat. This is not time for you to be gloating. And those of you who are Democrat, don't pout. We have to come together. We still have our city to reach, our own little world. And so if ever there's a time, we need to come together, because the most important thing is not if we're a Democrat, not if we're a Republican. Hey, we're a born-again believer, and there's people that need Jesus Christ. We cannot lose the passion of souls.
Gentlemen? Well, you know, I pastored a church where it was pretty much divided, you know, right down the middle.
Oh, yeah.
So I'm hearing both sides.
Right.
And one of the things that I'm trying to do is just to allow people to see that, you know, that our brotherhood in Christ, yeah, you know, trumps everything else. You know, if you go on in that, Trump, that's a...
that was a slip.
Yeah, but, you know, if you go on and read that passage in Psalm 133, it's like the oil that came down upon Aaron's head and flowed down his beard. And one of the things that when I've taught that, you know, that oil symbolizes the Holy Spirit.
Amen,
and
brother.
Then when that oil came down Aaron's beard, it dripped down the front of his garments. You know, it symbolized oneness, that his whole body was not a head, a chest, legs, but that oil symbolized the oneness. And that's what, you know, we ought to be able to do, to put aside any differences that we have and come together in the body of Christ and allow each other to have their political differences without affecting me in the way I look at you.
Well, gentlemen, you remember we did the In God We Trust campaign.
Yes.
Which and we great. Challenged our brothers and sisters in Christ to go out and vote. Well, the good news, Christians went out and voted in record numbers.
Yes.
But divided pretty evenly. I mean, our nation was pretty much evenly divided for the Democratic candidate and for the...
Not all those Christians voted for the same
person. No. You know, we can't say Christians are Republicans or Christians are Democrats. Christians are both. I like the idea that we don't even classify ourselves as Democrats or Republicans.
Right.
We should just be Christians.
Right.
But, Pastor Jay, how do you go to those folks in your congregation that were on both sides of that equation and got very passionate about it. Some got very passionate about it, and then start bringing them together on that common denominator of Jesus.
One of the realities is that no matter who got in office, we are going to be where we are now.
So that's one thing I tell people. It doesn't matter whether you voted for Hillary or whether you voted for Trump or none of the above. Right. You know, we are going to be where we are right now. But I believe that one of the things is that God allowed who he allowed in office.
That's right.
And so I think one of the things we do is we have to begin to position ourselves to say, it's over and done with. Mm-hmm. It's final. There's no sense mourning over Saul. Right. David's now in office. Not saying that he's David, but my point is that there's a new person in office now. Right. And now we begin to ask the Lord, what are you saying to us?
That's it.
What are you saying to the church now? Yeah. Now that he's in office, what are you doing? Because God has a plan in the middle of all this. So one of the things I told people, regardless of what's going on, whether you're Republican or Democrat, make sure you're a Christocrat. Right. And as long as you have him leading your life in this season, he's going to use...
I was going to steal your word, but you got it out there. Christocrat. I like that. I think this also exposes... So this election, as many elections do, I suppose, a lot of things, they expose what's really in the heart of people. And all of this emotion and this passion, I mean, I don't think there's anything wrong with that, but when you start letting that lead your mouth, lead your attitude, dictate how the relationships are going to have, that's exposing something bigger than Republican and Democrat. It's showing that your position in the Christocrat party, it may not be where you think it is, that we have to say, God, I need to honor you in everything I think, say, and do, my attitude, and how I agree and disagree with people.
Well, you know, to follow up on that, one of the things that I'm hearing is that, you know, he's not my president. Yeah. I mean, I'm getting a lot of that. And so I take them back to the passage in Timothy to say, whether you voted for him or not, you know, that you are commanded to pray for him. Mm-hmm. And then I said one thing, and some people took issue with this. I said, you are commanded to love him. You know, I said, there's no question. Jesus said, even if you feel he's your enemy, Jesus said, love your enemies. Right. And so, you know, you have to love them.
And then going back to what, again, thank you for saying that. In Matthew, talks about blessed are the peacemakers. So if ever there's a time, we as pastors, one thing for sure, our attitude cannot be seen here.
Right.
The attitude of Christ being a peacemaker. What I really appreciated that Sunday morning, there was such a wonderful presence of God in our church. I called the whole congregation together down around the altars, and the worship was just fantastic that morning. And I had people join hands. I said, hey, wait a minute, we got to be in unanimity here. Well, there's people here that's battling cancer. There's people here that are jobless. We got to focus in on the needs of the church now and forget about no human being is the answer. Jesus Christ is the answer. And if we can just get that into our people's lives.
And I heard someone say something really good. I didn't coin this right. They said, but rooting for Trump to fail is kind of like rooting, if you're on a plane, for your pilot to fail. He's guiding our nation at this time. So you better pray. Because you're living, unless you plan on moving to Mexico.
Or Canada.
Or Europe or Canada or something. Right. You better
all
hope he does well.
All the people said they were moving, they ain't going nowhere.
Well, some of those folks I'd like to see go.
But to your point, you say, and listen, 4 years ago and 8 years ago, people on the other side were saying the same thing.
Right.
He's not my president. He's not my president. The fact is if you are privileged to be able to say, I am an American, listen, whoever the country you live in elects, whether you elected them or not, or whether you voted for them or not, that is your president. Because God did not put you in a place to decide who is in office by your lone self. You are a part of something bigger than you. And God forgive us for the times that our heads have gotten a whole lot bigger than they should, that we are a part of something. By the way, God will know what to use in order to bring humility to people. He does it every 4 and 8 years.
But as I said around the table, that people are emotional. Oh, and when they make a statement that he's not my president, that's an emotional statement.
It is.
And I agree with you. You know, you have to deal with that attitude. But as a pastor, you know, that I have to keep myself in a position where I can minister to everybody, you know, and not just feel like, Pastor Glaze, you know, he leaned this way. So, you know, we can't really, talk to him about that. So, you know, I have to be in a position where, you know, people are hurting. I mean, really, I'm going to be honest with you. You know, and I'm sure the people felt like this after Obama got elected, but there are some people that feel that the world is almost coming to an end.
I know.
And they're crushed, you know, by this. And you know, that's when, as a pastor, you have to come in there skillfully and minister to that person.
Be the peacemaker. It,
right.
And we as pastors have to get a word from the Lord in this season. Yes. I believe he's speaking something new.
Yeah. That's it.
And I believe it's important for us that as we speak the word of the Lord, it's going to minister to those people, give them hope and encouragement.
And remember what Jesus said. Jesus said, if I am lifted up, I'll draw all men unto me.
Because he's not our Savior.
Yeah, because whoever you focus on is the object of your worship. And I'm going to tell you, there's no Trump, no Hillary, no nobody that is the object of my worship. Amen. Because there is only one that went to the cross for me, and I worship him in Jesus' name.
There you go. Amen. And I think that is our bottom line, good place for us to put a pencil mark here, is that there is great disappointment.
Oh, yes.
And there is great fear. There's great fear. Yeah. In my own family, there's great fear that we are going to fall apart as a nation, or we're going to do something that's going to embarrass us worldwide. But we put our faith in God.
That's right. Amen. That's
God
right.
is our source. Amen. And we're not dependent upon man. We are dependent upon God. We trust in Him. We prayed, we fasted, mm-hmm. and now let's support and yeah. keep praying and
That's
keep
right.
fasting.
That's right.
Let's not say it's over with, because it's not. It's just getting started. And let's move on out as the Church of Jesus Christ and Amen. Be salt and light in this culture. Amen. And let's hold Washington accountable. Yeah. Hey, yeah. Wouldn't that be unusual? Yeah. Wouldn't that be unusual? Yeah. The Christians would start right. saying, hey, we're going to hold you accountable.
Right. Yeah.
We're not going to show up every 8 years. We're going to hold you accountable.
It's about time.
And that's what in God we trust is going to do. Hey, send your questions, your hard questions to us at hardquestions@ctvn.org. We're ready to take them on. Let's go to Amy.
Wow, that was a hard question. The election division, and how should we as pastors handle it? You know, from the very words of Jesus, He said, "Peace I leave with you, my peace that I give to you. Not as the world giveth, give I you. Let not your heart be troubled, nor let it be afraid." I wrote this out on a little card, and I put it in four places in my house, and it says, a heart at peace gives life to the body. You don't want a heart that's divided or full of hate or full of disunity or division. You want a heart that's at peace, that's going to give life to your very body. Now, the definition for that word peace, listen to these words, completeness, safety, soundness. This is what you're going to have when your heart is at peace. You're going to have good welfare and health and prosperity and peace and tranquility and contentment. And listen to this, you're going to have peace in human relationships. God's best for His people is unity in the body, unity with my brothers, with my sisters. We can be unified and disagree on certain subjects. It's okay to have a brain to think and to, but not let that division get into your heart. Here's what I want for you. I want you, number one, to have peace with God. If you've never made the decision to ask Jesus into your heart, I want you to do that so you'll be at peace with God, that you'll know that you are right before God. Pray this prayer. Say, Father God, forgive me of my sin. Come into my heart. Be the Lord and the Savior of my life. Give me peace in Jesus' name. And also what I want to do is I want to pray for unity in the body, that all of this division and hate that is trying to be stirred up and all of this disagreement and discord and tension, we pray right now for our country, for our churches, as brothers and sisters, as the body of Christ. We know that we're stronger when we're together, and we thank you that we'll be a unified force for the kingdom of God, that God blesses unity and agreement, and we want to be in God's best place in life, in Jesus' name. If you prayed the prayer of salvation, will you give us a call at 888-665-4483? We'd love to hear from you. We want you to have peace with God and peace with man. Man, coming up, another miracle in American history, how a storm gave American forces an advantage over the British. We'll be right back.
We've seen God's mighty hand begin to work in our nation, but we must continue to stand for the gospel, not just for America, but also for our families. I wrote a special devotional that daily feeds our spirits and renews our mind. I named it Turning the Tide, because every day we must push back the waves of darkness and begin to walk in the light and in the power of the Holy Spirit.
When the enemy comes in like a flood, the Spirit of the Lord will lift up a standard against him. With your best gift, we will send you Don's brand new 2017 daily devotional. We believe that prayer with fasting and the Word of God will turn the tides in our favor. Call or go online today to receive your copy of Don Black's 2017 devotional, Turning the Tide.
You know, it's very important for you and for me to every day feed our spirits. Every day. You know, the sad statistic is most of us don't read the Bible every day. Most of us don't read the Bible every week. Those of us who go to church look at the Bible when the pastor's speaking. That's very important that we change, brothers and sisters. I'm not putting any condemnation on you because I love you and I just want you to grow. I want you to become more of what God wants you to be, all that God wants you to be. So that's why I did Turning the Tide, this devotional. It's a daily devotional and it will feed your spirit and encourage you every day with a rhema from God. At least it gives you the opportunity to hear from God, and he may or may not make that a rhema in your life. He does often in mine, and he'll just turn his word and make it come alive. And then as you grow and as you keep going and you discipline yourself, you got to discipline yourself. Find a place, make it your special place, and read this in your Bible. This is nothing other than the word in here that makes this special, but we want to give it to you as our gift to you as part of this ministry. As a partner with Cornerstone, that means you pray for us. That means you make financial contributions to us as the Lord would lead you to do that. And when you do, we'll send you this for the month of December. If you haven't partnered with us yet and you would like to, we still have a chance to close this year off strong, and we need your partnership. So come and join us. Call 888-665-4483 and say, I want to be a part of the Cornerstone family. Send me the devotional. On today's Miracle in American History, I love history. We're going to talk about more history just coming up in just a few minutes. William J. Federer shares how a force of nature, don't you love that kind of terminology, a force of nature, gave American forces an edge over the British. Let's take a look.
Are you aware of this miracle in American history? James Madison, he was known as the chief architect of the Constitution, writing many of the Federalist Papers, which convinced the states to ratify the U.S. Constitution. Madison even introduced the First Amendment in the first session of Congress. At the onset of the War of 1812, President James Madison proclaimed a day of prayer, July 9, 1812, stating, I do therefore recommend rendering the sovereign of the universe public homage, acknowledging the transgressions which might justly provoke his divine displeasure, seeking his merciful forgiveness, and with a reverence for the unerring precept of our holy religion, to do to others as they would require that others should do to them. The next year, on July 23, 1813, Madison issued another day of prayer referring to that, quote, religion, that gift of heaven for the good of man. On April 6, 1814, Napoleon abdicated in Europe and was exiled to the island of Elba. This freed up the British forces. Nearly 1,000 American vessels were captured, and 3 invasion armies were sent to New York, New Orleans, and Washington, D.C. On August 24, 1814, a force of 4,500 British troops marched toward Washington, D.C. In a panic, citizens hastily evacuated. Dolly Madison is credited with saving the Gilbert Stuart portrait of George Washington by having it cut out of its frame. She rode out of town on a carriage as British Admiral George Cockburn rode into Washington, D.C. Admiral Cockburn entered the White House. He ate dinner, then set it on fire. He had his British soldiers sit in the congressman's chairs in our Congress, and he held a mock Congress. He went to the speaker's chair and he said, who votes to burn the American Capitol? And they all said, I. And they proceeded to torch the U.S. Capitol, the Treasury Office, the Patent Office, the Library of Congress, and they even attacked the Navy Yard, but were turned back by the brave Marines. Suddenly, dark clouds rolled in, and wind and thunder grew to a frightening roar. Lightning began striking. A tornado touched down, sending debris flying, blowing off roofs and chimneys, knocking down walls on the British troops. Violent winds slapped horse and rider to the ground. The book Washington Weather recorded British Admiral George Cockburn exclaiming to a lady, great God, madame, is this the kind of storm to which you are accustomed to in this infernal country? To which the lady replied, no, sir, this is a special interposition of Providence to drive our enemies from our city. A British historian wrote, more British soldiers were killed by this stroke of nature than from all the firearms the American troops had mustered in the feeble defense of their city. As the British forces fled, torrential rains fell for hours, extinguishing the fires. The British marched back to their ships with difficulty on roads covered with downed trees, only to find 2 ships blown ashore. and others with damaged rigging. On September 1, 1814, Madison wrote, "The enemy, by a sudden incursion, has succeeded in invading the capital of the nation during their possession, though for a single day only. They wantonly destroyed public edifices, an occasion which appeals so forcibly to the patriotic devotion of the American people, none will forget. Independence is now to be maintained with the strength and resources which heaven has blessed." Less than 3 months later, Madison proclaimed a national day of public humiliation, fasting, and prayer to Almighty God on November 16, 1814, stating, "The two houses of the national legislature have, by a joint resolution, expressed their desire that in the present time of public calamity and war, a day may be recommended to be observed by the people of the United States as a day of public humiliation and fasting and a prayer to Almighty God for the safety and welfare of these states, his blessings on their arms, and a speedy restoration of peace, of confessing their sins and transgressions, of strengthening their vows of repentance, that he would graciously please to pardon all their offenses. I have deemed it proper to recommend a day of humble adoration to the great sovereign of the universe." Well, that was President James Madison during the War of 1812, where America faced the most powerful military force in the world. And even when our military was not able to defend Washington, D.C., a miraculous storm did. America, it's important for us to remember these miracles in American history.
You know, guys, it's every time we hear about how God supernaturally stepped in and saved us from almost certain destruction.
Right.
Almost certain destruction. You got to ask the question, why? Why did God do that? I'm asking you.
Are you asking a question? Is that a rhetorical question?
It's a rhetorical question, but what do you think? Why would God do that in this country against the British in send those storms? Or did he? Or do you think it's just coincidental?
I believe it was an act of God, because we were coming away from the rule and the reign of a king, and we're coming to serve our God and to be one nation under God. And there was a pulling away so that we could establish this country on the principles of God. So I could see God's hand at work in the weather. Hello,
that's
he
right.
created the heavens and the earth
that's
and the
right.
hills
right.
and the mountains, and he can do whatever he needs to do.
Well, and it's a reminder to the United States. Is that what it was called back then, United States?
Sure.
How God was on there taking care of them. Mm-hmm. You know, he had their back. You know, I mean, Britain was coming back a second time
to
destroy them.
Well, they were the greatest power in the universe.
Right.
I mean, they were the superpower who were humbled and embarrassed by our revolution.
Mm-hmm.
And they were coming back to kind of make do, you know, get even. And they could have, and they would have, and they should have.
Yeah.
They should have just taken.
Could have, would have, should have.
They should have.
But
those two words, you know, the
but
two words.
God.
But God.
Amen.
But God. And then, you know, what our leadership in Washington had the good sense to do was recognize that.
Absolutely.
And to call for a day of prayer, fasting, and humiliation, just in the presence of God to say thank you.
Absolutely.
We need to expect God's divine intervention and not put God in a box. He can use whatever he needs to work something out for us, for our country, for the election, for
Absolutely.
Bringing unity in our country.
What about
like
protection
you were talking
against
about?
Terrorism?
Yeah.
Why don't we have a day of prayer, fasting, and humiliation as we repent and ask the Lord to put security back in our land?
Absolutely.
Secure our borders and protect
right.
us against terrorists.
Right.
Let's go to Washington. Let's come out of the White House with that type of a referendum. Man, that's what we need. Well, that would be good news. Sydney finds it's good news everywhere she looks. Sydney.
I'm Sydney Grant for Good News 360. Here's how the Holy Spirit is moving around the world. Christian television is reaching millions in the Middle East. More than 21 million people watch the station Sat7. That's an increase of 76% in 5 years. The station says both Saudi Arabia and Syria have a significant number of viewers. Network execs say factors contributing to the channel's growth include ongoing unrest in the region and the public's distrust in religious and political leadership. A Canadian couple is providing care for victims of Boko Haram in Nigeria. Nigerian Christians are a major target of the militant group's terrorism. The couple serves as field officers and developers with Voice of the Martyrs. They give trauma care and also pray for those who've witnessed horrific atrocities. And London turned red in honor of those persecuted for their faith. Westminster Abbey, Houses of Parliament, and other landmarks in the city changed color to draw attention to people oppressed for their beliefs. The Catholic charity Aid to the Church in Need created the initiative. That's all for Good News 360. Have a great day on purpose.
You know, on our one of our recent bus trips, and we like these bus trips.
Right, we do.
You
know, they're
fun.
We meet a lot of great
they're
people.
They're fun, and we meet a lot of good people. And on this trip, we met retired Army General Larry Powell. He's here today to talk about his life and what God's done in his life and about history. Gee, get that. Surprise, surprise.
What a connection.
General, so glad that you're here.
Glad to be here.
Welcome,
yes,
welcome, welcome.
Lovely. So glad, yes. And you brought your wife, too, Marlene. So.
She's sitting on the sideline.
That's
today.
Right. Being a cheerleader.
Well, introduction to you. You served our nation proudly for many years. Give us just your 60,000-foot resume of your military service.
Well, for the last 5 years of a 35-year career, I served as the Deputy Commanding General for the 28th Infantry Division, which is the Keystone Division, Pennsylvania's division.
Oh, cool.
And it was a great honor, great privilege to be able to do that.
Yeah, we honor your service and thank you for
you.
It.
Yes, thank you.
Thank you,
you
for
so
you saw you were in some key times in our nation's history. And speaking of the nation's history, we want to talk about leadership. When we talk about leadership, and as a military man, you know how important leadership is. You cannot lead men and women in the military without proper guidance. What's your secret to leadership?
Well, we have to have in the military of the United States, which is an army of liberation. Mm-hmm. And we found ourselves in our nation's history way back before even Washington, the Mayflower Compact, which the settlement of the country was to be for the honor mm-hmm. of Jesus Christ. Mm-hmm. And we find George Washington, his whole career was protected, as he said, divine providence.
That's right. Mm-hmm.
And we find him transitioning off of the military life, and then in 1799 he passed away. We moved on into the time of the 1800s, and slavery was a black mark in our history and our land. Mm-hmm. And God raised up, as he always has, as he raised up Washington, protected him. He raised up Abraham Lincoln. Mm-hmm. And we found the army now being splintered because of the secession of the South, who believes states' rights. Mm-hmm. The North, the Union, the army wanted to protect, mm-hmm. preservation of the Union. So we find ourselves in 1863 with this war going on. 1862, Abraham Lincoln had issued his Emancipation Proclamation. Now that was to be codified on the field of battle at Gettysburg, yeah. The high water mark of the Confederacy.
It was indeed. Let's back up just a little bit into the Army of the United States before the Civil War in 1860 was not much of an army.
Correct.
Some 16,000 or so soldiers that were in the field. Mostly out west. General Robert E. Lee, a career man like yourself in the U.S. Army, was challenged in 1861 to decide which side he was going to go on. He was offered the leadership of the Union Army, a great privilege. He was a colonel at that point. He would have been made commander-in-chief, I guess not, I'd be president, but chief commander of the U.S. Army, but he chose a different route.
He did. That is why unity of purpose and unity of command go together. Mm-hmm. And that's an imperative in an army like ours, which is not a standing army for occupation. It's mm-hmm. for the liberation. Mm-hmm. And so we see the unity of purpose being splintered in Robert E. Lee, Stonewall Jackson, mm-hmm. both brilliant men. Lee was the top strategist, perhaps, of military history. And Stonewall Jackson was his executor, tactically in the field. And so they're at Gettysburg now, minus Stonewall Jackson.
See, that's the thing, minus Stonewall Jackson. Mm-hmm. Lee in Gettysburg facing 2-1 odds, double union to his Confederate troops without the tactical implementation of a Stonewall Jackson proved to be very damaging for the Confederate Army.
Absolutely. There's so many instances on that field of battle. Sandhurst, West Point, they send their officers down to study Gettysburg. Mm-hmm. What happened was they didn't have Stonewall Jackson be able to, in a timely manner, execute on July 1, 2, and 3.
That's right.
Lee's strategy mm-hmm. at Gettysburg.
Mm. Well, we're not going to point fingers at people who didn't fulfill their duties as they would have been hoped to. What kind of leader was General Lee? What kind of leader was he?
He was a Christian, number one.
Right.
He was a man who earned the respect of his people because he led from the front. He was compassionate. He was tactically and technically proficient. Mm-hmm. And that respect and that love for God trickled down in through the command. They would go anywhere and do anything for him.
Because he was a man, I'm sorry, Terry. You're gonna have to get in.
I know. I'm just getting in. And I know you guys are gonna be really bummed at this. I was gonna switch the subject just a minute. I wanted to find out, because of your history, 35 years in the military, have you encountered providences of God throughout your service in all the different fields? I mean, you're sharing about history with Robert E. Lee and all that kind of stuff. Have you experienced that yourself as a leader in the military?
Yes, in my life personally. Mm. Let me tell you that. I was a Christian from a young age, but I was really not following the Lord. I had too much of self. I was directing my career, so to speak, from the sidelines. And God intervened. Mm. And I can remember on two occasions where divine providence came into my life. Mm-hmm. And the one was when I finally quit running from God, as a Christian, running from God, and listened to Him and become my Lord. Not just my Savior, but my Lord.
And that helped you throughout your career in the military?
Absolutely.
How old were you when that happened?
About 28 years old.
28.
Really? Mm-hmm.
So you were in the military and you were early in your career.
Yes, mm-hmm. Yes. And then a few years later, I find myself saying, God, I don't want to fail you. Mm-hmm. It puts this impression that if I was left to myself again, I would mess things up.
Right.
And that unity of purpose, which is glorify Jesus Christ in everything we do. Mm-hmm. He's the commander in chief.
That's right. Mm-hmm. That's right.
And when I made him that, and when I decided to be subjugated to his authority, mm-hmm. to his leadership, mm-hmm. as commander in chief, I then could be used of him in the military.
Wow. Mm-hmm. That's awesome. And I am so sure that in your whole career and in your life, you have also not only worked in military, but you've become quite the expert of military history.
Oh, yeah.
Well, I wouldn't say expert.
Yeah.
Well, no experts. Well, good experts,
yes,
never say they are.
They are. That's
You certainly are, brother. And that I'm looking forward. I like to go on the trips with General Powell because mm-hmm. we can sometimes get away and talk a little
bit
about
it. We're going next
week. We're going next
week.
Right.
That's
the kind of people that you go on these trips with. What's the state of our readiness in our nation's military now? From your, I know you're outside the perspective, but what's your, many have said we're not ready. We have a weakened army, weakened defense. What do you think?
We have a strong, strong cadre of dedicated professionals that is the heart and core of our military. The problem is that our government, our leadership, has used the military as social experimentation. Mm. And there has been a loss of focus on this unity of purpose, unity of command. Mm-hmm. The minute we take Jesus Christ out of the center, out of the leadership, we diminish.
Wow.
And so we're looking forward,
yes, sir,
to a improved position in the military.
It broke my heart when the chaplains in the military were, Christian chaplains, were not allowed to talk about Jesus.
That's right.
Mm-hmm. That broke my heart. How do you minister to soldiers without being able to talk about Jesus?
You can't.
Well, that's how it's, and that has to change. We've got to bring freedom of religion back to our military.
That's right.
So thankful that you came. We've got to come back. Will you come back and be
Absolutely.
With us?
Yes.
Come back.
Love
we got so much to talk about. We could talk about Washington and all that he did in this area And maybe put a, we were talking about maybe
he
putting
could
a
do
trip,
a trip for I us. Say
maybe do
on
a little
that. That
Washington
sounds great.
Trip. Yeah. We're so glad that we have friends, and we're so glad you get to meet them. And let's go to Amy.
Wow, what a privilege to have General Powell in our studio. Inspirational, powerful, what a leader. I'm so thankful, I know you are too, for all of the men and women who have fought and who have served for our great country. You know, we're coming upon Pearl Harbor Day in about 6 days. And man, it just, it all of this miracles in American history and the providence of God, is just, it's kind of stirring me up today. Just a grateful heart. And I hope you have a grateful heart today, that we get our eyes off of ourselves. You know, we're so busy right now with Christmas and all that we have to do and all that we have to get done and the gifts we have to get and the presents and the food and the family. Let's lift our eyes up a little bit higher and let's see a bigger picture and let's have a grateful heart. There's so much to be thankful for, and we are very thankful for you. We're thankful that you're a part of our family. We're thankful that you tune in every day. When we're out there talking with you and meeting you, it just feels like we're good friends. So we love to do Real Life with you. Well, next on Real Life, we'll find out the history and the mystery of the meaning behind the Christmas hymns of the early Greek Byzantine church. Don and Terry will interview experts Nick Giannoukakis and Tom Boudros to fill us in on the tradition. But first, here is a sample of the Byzantine Christmas hymn.
Just something, Terry, about the hymns and the chanting of
right.
it comes up out of your heart, out of
right.
your spirit.
Well, I appreciate the just the blending of all of the music together and
so
the
glad,
voices.
We're mm-hmm. so glad, Nick and Tom, you're here with us to
yes.
talk about this.
Mm-hmm.
How did you get involved in this? Who can go first?
I can start. I had a light bulb in the head, touched by God moment mm-hmm. of all places in my church. the priest, who was Father Nick Powell at the time, put out a plea at Easter time that the cantors there needed some help for the Easter Passion period. And it involved a lot of reading. And I just thought, I can do this. And at the time, I went to the head chanter at the Ambridge Church, who was a very good friend of mine, Stavro Vujas, and he taught me. We went, I met his house two or three times a week, and slowly got into it. All memorization now, no...
I know, that's the thing about it, this is not... This is very, very technical. Nick, how about you? How did you get involved?
Well, from the age of seven, I was very blessed to attend a church where one of the world's most renowned cantors of Byzantine chant, Professor Konstantin Laguros, was directing a small chorale. And initially, against the wishes of my parents, I did not want to go to church. But then again, as Tom mentioned, that spark came inside of me. And I started going, and under his personal tutelage, I learned both the technical aspects of the music and also the more historical aspects of the music and how it evolved. And then over the years in my adolescence, traveling to Greece, unlike my friends who were enjoying the beaches and all the wonderful things Greece has to offer, I spent time with even more renowned cantors, Emmanuel Hadzimarkos and George Sirkas, who are legendary in the field.
Now, Byzantine, I know that it's predominantly in Greek history. How is it different than, like, all the other you know, the Catholic and all that. How is that different?
So interestingly enough, Byzantine music evolved from Ambrosian and Gregorian chant. It's a more rhythmic, it's a more metered type of music. It's not just plain chant where you have melody just meandering, but there's a lot of rhythm, there's a lot of meter to it. The music was basically composed on top of the poetry, and much of the early church poetry up until the 8th century is actually modeled exactly on passages from ancient Greek drama, the Iliad, the Odyssey, works of Pindar, Aristophanes, Euripides, and it's incredible. So they had to meter the music, it had to be tempoed and metered out on the poem.
So they based it on the word, the poetry first, correct, and then added the music.
Right, right. Correct. That's just what I was going to say. And then you got, it's been, I don't know how many hundreds of years from the beginnings of the written form, you said it was 1,500 or more years ago, many hundreds of years, this has been a tradition, and it's not, you don't do variety of it. It's very much the same today as it was 400 or 500 years ago.
For most of the hymns that are used in the Matins service and the Vesper services, because the poetry has not changed at all, it's the same poetry that was composed in the 5th and the 6th century and onwards, we don't have any hard evidence, but because the poetry was conserved, it is believed that the music to accent the word also has not changed all that much, that poetry at least. What changed was the longer melodies, the more virtuoso melodies, and this change happened at about the 15th, 16th century. But those hymns that you heard in the clip, those are very likely unchanged since the 9th, 10th century.
How many voices do you have to have? How many have to be in the ensemble for it to work?
Three people is all you need.
Really?
So, yep. Mm-hmm. So traditionally in an Orthodox church, you need a cantor, right, the main voice, the melody, and you need two individuals who hold either the root of the fourth or the fifth, if we can use European music, right, to describe this, or the dominants, mm-hmm, that you accentuate the fourths and the fifths and the thirds. And so you create that harmony. It's a simple form of harmony that also accents but doesn't distract from the words.
It doesn't come up out of your vocal cords.
It actually comes from the diaphragm. The vocal, right, cords shape the trills and possibly some of the embellishments and some of, okay, the grace notes and things like that. But the actual music, the actual rhythm, the rhythm has to come from the diaphragm technically.
Okay, I need to ask. I have not been to a Greek church before. So if I come to the church, your church, and I hear you singing, do I participate or am I listening? Do I follow along? What's my role as a parishioner?
You're always welcome to participate because the melody is simple.
Okay.
Because it accents the word. The emphasis is always on the word so that the Christian can understand and feel and sense God around them. Mm. The melodies are simple, and because of their simplicity, it's not hard to memorize them. And so, yes, you're encouraged to participate.
We have a little clip. Let's go to that. We have a second clip that we want to show, so let's watch that. When you sing, when you're in that type of, I'm going to ask you a spiritual question. Do you feel God's lifting of those words? You know what the words mean, but do you feel His Spirit's lifting as you sing those songs?
Yes, you do. You're actually in a zone. You're oblivious to everything else around you. And it just, you're chanting from your heart, from you're singing to God.
Wow.
Is what you're doing.
What a great form of art. I think, you know, all art comes from God. From my worldview, all art comes from God. And this is art that reflects Him. Thank you for coming and sharing.
Thank you.
Maybe we'll,
yes,
get you guys, maybe you guys will come back. We can figure out how you come back and,
right,
do some music, some chanting, some hymns here in our studio where we have a really great sound. I think it'd be phenomenal
to
do that.
And also, we heard it in Greek. but Nick was sharing that it's been translated into English as well. So I think that would be, you know, it'd be great to see both translations. So,
well, let's work on that. That'd be fun to do that.
It'll be our honor. Thank you very much.
Well, let's go to this spot, and when we come back, we're going to be praying for your prayer requests.
Oscar Wilde once said, "I can resist anything but temptation." Listen, have you been there, done that, got the t-shirt, been tempted? Well, tune in to the next Nightlife, where we're talking about temptation, how to overcome it. And we've got Dr. Bill Glaze here, and he has walked through it all, and he's got 50 ways to overcome it, 50 ways to deal with it. And the guys sing a song. It is great. It's amazing. 10:30, Friday, Saturday night.
Want a way to share Bible verses, inspirational photos, or uplifting videos with your friends and family online? Like the Cornerstone Television page on Facebook. Every day we'll keep you updated on show info, behind-the-scenes facts, and daily inspiration from our exclusive photos, videos, quotes, and more. Go to facebook.com/cornerstonetelevision to connect with us. We want to hear from you. Let's spread the good news of Jesus to our family and friends online.
We look at God's Word every day on Real Life. Today we're going to look at Isaiah, the 7th chapter, the 14th verse. Here in the Christmas, we're in the Christmas stretch. This is what the Word says. "Therefore, the Lord himself will give you a sign. Behold, the virgin shall conceive and bear a son, and shall call his name Emmanuel." You know, Emmanuel means God with us. Think about what the Father did for us. Now think about it with me. He brought his son into the world as a sign of his love. He supernaturally placed him into Mary, who was a virgin, in order to completely eliminate the Adam sin. Then Jesus, he is God with us. He continues to be with us by the presence of his Holy Spirit in our lives today. That's the miracle of Christmas, guys. Yeah. God put his son into a virgin who brought forgiveness and salvation into the world. What a miracle.
Oh, that is a miracle. And I've always loved calling God Emmanuel, God with us. I mean, if you think about it, he's with us. I love that that's what his name means, God with us.
The thing that Pastor Jay, that people just, they don't connect, is when God's with you, there are other things with you.
That's right.
You know?
That's right.
He's just not there on the side watching. When God's with you, there is victory. There's his fruits of his Spirit, the gifts of the Spirit. There are all of the presence. God doesn't stand in a vacuum. He changes the atmosphere in me.
Well, just practically, he's with you in your kitchen when you're cooking and preparing and you're working through battles with spouse or kids or work or money. God is with you. He'll help you. Listen to his voice. Listen to the nudges on the insides as he says, do this, don't do that, stop this, call that person, go here, do this for your body. Like, he's here with us practically to help us in life live a victorious life.
Absolutely. So God tells you who to call.
You know, I do. I get nudges. Like, somebody will keep coming.
Describe that nudge, though. Tell people what that nudge feels like.
Well, like, I'll think of this lady's name. Let's say Elizabeth. And I'll keep thinking, Elizabeth. And then, like, I'm in the kitchen. I'm like, why do I keep thinking about Elizabeth? Mm-hmm. And then I'll give Elizabeth a call and say, hey, I'm thinking about you and praying for you. And then cry. You have no idea. Mm-hmm. And this is going on. And then we pray. And because God cares about Elizabeth.
That's right.
God cares about people, his kids, and about you being obedient to that little still small voice, the little nudges in life.
That's right.
Pastor Jay, it's that simple, isn't it?
It is. And, you know, and sometimes you don't know why you're stepping out. You don't know why you're making that phone call. Yeah. And sometimes God will reveal it to you as you go. He just wants you to take that initial step, you know, and that's what's so important, you know. But you were talking about Emmanuel being God with us. You know, when the Holy Spirit came upon Mary, I think one of the unique things, it's kind of a shadow and a type a little bit of what's going to happen to us and when we get saved. You know, the Holy Spirit comes upon us, he regenerates us, and now we're now full of that character of Christ Jesus now inside of us. So now what happened in Mary happens inside of us, and now everything that he is now inside of us as believers, and we have access to. So that leading is the Holy Spirit just leading us to be the Jesus hands and feet to whoever.
And if there's no action and no faith behind that, that you can just conceive and it just sort of stay there and not come full forth.
That's right.
You know, you want that gift of God to be fully developed and well-formed in you mm-hmm. and working out of you.
Yeah, and you know, a lot of times when we get those small voices, you know, of to do something, sometimes we go, oh, I don't know if I should do that. That's sort of dumb. I heard once, and I really believe that if we're there to benefit somebody, to extend the love of Jesus, then we should never question that. You know, like, right. Oh, it's not of God or not. I mean, if you're there to give some loving to somebody, mm-hmm. to, you know, it's not your call to say, oh, I shouldn't do that. You just need to be his hands and feet and not right. question what God is what the motivation is. Just trust God for that.
Just like the beautiful harmony of the Byzantine church and mm-hmm. the hymns. I mean, that's the body of Christ. And right. when one is helping another and we're serving one another, loving one, it makes a beautiful harmony.
Absolutely, it does.
We've got several prayer requests that we want to mm-hmm. pray for. I got a praise report first. Amen. That she prayed that she would get a job and that now she has two part-time jobs to pay her way through college.
Yay!
Hallelujah.
Yay.
Hallelujah. That's good.
I think she wanted to make sure you knew that so she wasn't going to get any loans out. Remember you talked about the beginning about loans? So.
Well, I mean, you know, getting loans isn't bad.
Right. I'm not putting, we have loans.
We do. We do that. Mm-hmm. You just have to do it right, manage it right. Let's pray together. Lord, we're thankful that you are with us. Emmanuel.
Yes, Lord.
You are with us, Father God. Not just watching us, but in us.
In us.
Yes.
You put in us all that we need to be successful in life, Father, the success that you determine. Lord, we pray for every one of these prayer requests that you will fill them with that knowledge of your presence, God. Help them know the hope of the calling that you put yes. into their heart, Lord. And empower them, Holy Spirit,
Hallelujah.
To rise up
yes.
and do in them what they can't do for themselves,
Hallelujah.
Father. And we thank you for Jesus in this
thank
Christmas
you,
season. We thank you that you sent your son. And it's in his name we pray. Amen and amen.
Amen.
Well, guys, this has been a real different kind of program
yeah.
and enjoying
exciting.
It. I hope you've enjoyed it too. I hope you've been touched in your spirit. That's why we do Real Life, to bring you a little piece of heaven. God has a plan for your life, and we'll see you on the next Real Life.
You may have heard people on Cornerstone mention Roku, but what is it? Roku is a device that connects to your television and streams thousands of channels from all around the world, including CTVN. You can watch your favorite Cornerstone shows 24/7, anywhere from around the world. Roku is helping us take the gospel as far as possible and as quickly as possible. For more information on how to connect with us on Roku, go to ctvn.org/Roku.
Don't miss Hard Questions, where pastors come together and tackle the hard issues of the day and the questions of life right out of the scripture. This week, we ask, Can I Lose My Salvation? Part 1. All that and more on Hard Questions Thursday at 10 a.m., 9 p.m., and Sundays at 4:30 p.m. Don't miss it.
Cornerstone Television wishes to thank all our faithful viewers whose consistent prayers and financial support have made this program possible.